So when we met last, we were discussing how to realize a comparator that doesn't chatter around when the inputs are very small, when the input is very small, okay? That is, let's say we want to compare something to 0, we can potentially use a saturating op-amp. Now, in this case, if Vi is smaller than 0, Vout should be equal to the upper saturation voltage, and if it is greater than 0, the output will be the negative saturation voltage. Now, the problem is if Vi is very small and then is wiggling around a little bit because of noise, the output will keep chattering between the positive and negative saturation, that is undesirable. So, what you would like to do is, if the output is positive, that is if Vi happens to be less than 0, then to switch it in the other direction to make the output negative, that is to give an indication that the input has become positive, you want it to cross a threshold of not 0, but something more than 0, okay. So, that is, let us say, over time, this is the threshold we would have wanted, but so let us say the input is changing like this. To avoid this chattering around when the input is very small, what you want is, when the input is negative, you want it to cross something that is positive, okay. And then when the input is positive, when it is going in the other direction, output to change when it crosses not 0, but some negative value, okay. So, such a thing is known as hysteresis, right. So, that means that actually there would not be a response at the ideal value of 0, but there will be some lag. So, that is what hysteresis means, but the advantage is that it would not have this business of chatter when the input signal is very small, okay. Because around here, even if the input wiggles around, it will change once, but it won't change back, because once it changes, it has to cross the other threshold to get back, okay. You have already used the Schmitt trigger in the lab, maybe you also followed the lectures, you know how it works. And the way to do that is, so Vi is less than 0. Then set a positive threshold when you want to cross the detection. So, you can see that the threshold that you want is the same polarity as the output. So, an easy way to implement this is, that you divide the output and put it there. So, assuming that initially Vi is very large and negative, the output will be a positive value. What will be this voltage? What will that voltage be? Vsat times the resistive division ratio R1 by R1 plus R2. So, now if you plot V0 versus Vi, what will that look like? What will the output be if the input is very large and negative? Positive. So, it will be somewhere here, okay. Now, I go on increasing the input. When does it change? When does the output change? Yeah, it will be whenever it crosses this number, right? Vsat times R1 by R1 plus R2, and it crosses that, okay. Now, when Vi is large and positive, the output will be negative. Now, when I come back, what happens when I go on reducing Vi? Yeah, so the threshold would have changed to minus Vsat times R1 by R1 plus R2. So, it has to actually cross that way. So, now this is a weird characteristic. For the same value of input, there are two possible values. So, essentially it has a state, it has memory, right. So, For instance, if the input is somewhere here, what the output is depends on how it got there. Okay. If it got there from the left side, it will be plus V sat. If it got there from the right side, it will be minus V sat. Okay. So, that is known as a state, right? Something depends on, something that depends on the history. So, typically you mark arrows like this to indicate which way it is. And of course, once it is beyond this box, the output is uniquely defined for a given input. So, such a characteristic is known as hysteresis, and it can be as wide or as narrow as you want. So, it has a useful function as you saw in the one of the bases to make an oscillator, right. So, you put an integrator and a Schmitt trigger in a feedback loop. What happens is the integrator will always be kind of unstable, that is, it will be either ramping up or ramping down. Now, if you have a Schmitt trigger in the feedback loop with the appropriate polarity, what happens is once the integrator output crosses a certain threshold, it will switch the input integrator's input in the opposite direction. So, it will starts ramping down. So, this is perpetually unstable. The integrator never reaches a constant output, right, because the integrator input is never 0, and that is exactly what you want from an oscillator. An oscillator is an unstable system in the sense that there is no input to an oscillator, it gives an output, right. So, if you have a stable system, if you have 0 input, eventually the output should go to 0. There may be some natural response, but it should eventually go to 0. But if you have an unstable system, there is no input as such, but there will be an output. Okay. And an oscillator is a useful block which is unstable. Is this okay? Now, this is a negative polarity comparator. That means that if Vi is smaller than 0, the output will be plus V sat, and if Vi is greater than 0, the output will be minus V sat. Okay. So, this is known as the inverting Schmitt trigger. Schmitt trigger is a word for some comparator which has hysteresis, and you can also make a non-inverting Schmitt trigger. How would you do that? So, you can do it, I mean it is certainly not by like flipping the signs of this, you get a completely different circuit. I won't go into the details, you can evaluate the characteristic yourself, and I think this is what you used in the oscillator also. So, when you see circuits like this, first you have to see, I mean op amp circuits, the op amps can be negative or positive feedback. First you have to judge whether op amps are in negative feedback or not. If they are in negative feedback, then they will be virtually, the inputs will be virtually shorted, and you can use that for circuit analysis. If they are not in negative feedback, of course, you cannot assume the inputs are virtually shorted. So, it is very likely that the outputs are saturated. So, you have to assume that the outputs are saturated one way or the other, and then do the analysis and confirm whether your assumptions are right. Okay. So, the other Schmitt trigger that we analyzed just now. These are Schmitt triggers and these are amplifiers. Okay. I mean it looks like somehow you miswired an amplifier to get the other one, and that is what will happen if you do miswire it. Okay. But one of the interesting things you can do is plot V naught versus Vi of this and this on the same axis to proper scale, and then also maybe on this one, of this one and that one. Okay. You can try doing that with saturation, of course. Is this okay? So, a Schmitt trigger is basically a comparator, but which has some hysteresis, meaning the threshold will depend on the state. Okay. And the motivation behind using hysteresis is to avoid chatter when the input is very small. Okay. Because if you do have a comparator whose characteristic is like this, right? That is what looks like a comparator. It switches from 1 to 0 when vi is 0, but then the problem with this is, as I said, if the input is wiggling around here, the output will also be chattering around. Okay. Any questions about this? Now, how did you make the oscillator? We had the integrator. By the way, did we discuss the stabilization? So, this by itself will not work at all, okay, because the output will very soon reach saturation. Now, if the offset of the op amp is miraculously 0 and then you also assume that there is no noise whatsoever, it could work, but this is like a theoretical condition which will never occur in practice. So, in practice you will always have the output to be saturated after a little while. Now, in case of the oscillator, so somehow or the other you have to have DC negative feedback around the op amp. And one way of doing that we saw was, what did we do? Use a resistor in feedback. Okay. Now, of course, we have changed the circuit. This is no longer the same integrator that we had. We saw that this does behave approximately like an integrator for a certain range of frequencies, or in the time domain for short durations after you apply the input, it behaves like an integrator. Okay. So, we have analyzed this in both time and frequency domains. Basically, this is a first order low pass filter with a DC gain of RF by R, and if you make the DC gain RF by R large, it will look like roughly like an integrator. Okay. The DC gain of an integrator is infinity. Now, to at least approximate it, you have to have the DC gain of this to be a large number. Is this okay? So, in the time domain we saw that for a step input this will do this, whereas an ideal integrator would have done that. So, if you do not look here, if you look only in this region, you can pretend that this is an integrator. Okay. So, sometimes it is done that way. Now, in case of the Schmidt-Rigger oscillator though, then also the integrator will be operating like an integrator. There it works slightly differently. We had the Schmidt-Rigger. So, what happens is, let us assume that somehow the Schmidt-Rigger's output is at positive saturation, then this will push a current into the resistor and then which goes into the capacitor, okay, assuming that it is virtual ground. Okay. Then what will the output do? What happens to the output in this condition? When the Schmidt-Rigger output is at the saturation voltage, positive saturation, what happens to the output of the integrator? It is decreasing or increasing? Decreasing. Why? So, the current is being pushed in this direction. So, that will increase the capacitor voltage that way, but this is at 0, assuming that this op amp is not saturated. So, that means that output will be decreasing. Now, what happens if it decreases beyond a certain value? The Schmidt-Rigger will switch to minus Vsat. Okay. So, then it will start pulling current, and then which will be pulled from the capacitor, and then now the output will start increasing and this will keep alternating. So, there is feedback around the integrator in some sort of an average sense. Because the Schmidt-Rigger will invert the polarity if the input of the Schmidt-Rigger goes out of its threshold region. Okay. Then what happens is the output of the integrator will be maintained within the saturation region. Okay. So, this op amp OPA1 will be operating in the high gain region, right? it will be, if the op amp characteristics are like this, VO versus VE, that will surely be operating here, because the output here will not be saturated. The Schmitt trigger will not allow it to saturate, right? Because once it goes beyond a certain level, the output will make the integrator go in the opposite direction. So, it will operate somewhere between these voltages. So, because it operates here, the input voltage is necessarily very small, and you can assume that to be virtual ground, okay. Whereas the other integrator OPA2, this is operating in positive feedback and its input is not small, okay. Its output is always saturated, either plus Vsat or minus Vsat, okay. So, the combination of these two, you can get an oscillator which you used. Any questions about this? And then there are some modifications you can make to this oscillator to change the slopes and change the frequency and so on. Okay, by itself, this one now has a frequency which is determined by R's and C's, right? The resistors and the capacitor. But you can also make it voltage controlled and so on. So, if you followed the lecture, you probably know that. Any questions about the oscillator? No, we don't, because the reason we had this here is, without it, the integrator's output will go to saturation. But now, this, we do have some feedback, and if you look at the action of the feedback, it will not allow it. Like, let us say for some reason, the integrator's output is increasing, but once it hits the positive threshold of the Schmitt trigger outputs will reverse, and then it will take the integrator in the opposite direction, right. So, in this case, you do not need that. No, you won't. Yeah. So, this will be a straight line. Actually, this can work if you have a large resistor, but there is no need to put it there, okay. So, if you have a resistor, for instance, instead of the output of the output here being a triangular wave, perhaps you could get something like that, okay. So, that is possible, you can analyze it, but it is not necessary to do it if you want to build an oscillator, okay. Any questions? And of course, the reason why the integrator is unstable should be quite clear. It has a pole on the imaginary axis. So, that means that it will never reach steady state, right. Any questions about any of these things? Did you solve the last problem in the tutorial, which asked something about one pole, two pole and so on? What happened? What was the result? Huh? Yeah, we have a feedback loop, and the op amp, instead of saying it has a gain A naught, some transfer function was given, right? Transfer function with one pole and then two poles and three poles and so on. So, what was the result of the analysis? What did you find? You won't get stability, okay. What about in the other cases when you have a single, it is always stable, okay. So, now why is this relevant? We will see that. I mean, there was a reason that question was given. I mean, as far as that question is concerned, if the op amp had a first order transfer function, that is, it behaved like a first order filter with a DC gain of A naught, then the closed loop, that is, with the feedback, you have some A naught by Vi, that is also first order, and you can find that the system is unconditionally stable. You of course, assume positive values of A naught, and the op amp by itself is not unstable and so on. Now, with the second order case, it is also stable, but we will see, I mean, it may not be have the best behavior, okay. It is also unconditionally stable. That means that when you make the amplifier, I think you were asked to, what was the circuit given? Non-inverting amplifier, is it? Yeah, the non-inverting amplifier, if you calculate the transfer function of the non-inverting amplifier, it will not have poles in the right half plane, okay. It will be definitely in the left half plane for any values of those numbers, as long as A naught is positive and that P1, P2 are positive and so on. I mean, the third order case, it is different. If the op amp has three poles inside it, you put it in a feedback loop, it can become unstable, right. If you plot I think you plotted the locus of the roots or something, it will go into the right half plane for some values of a naught. So you have to be very careful. Now, why is all this relevant? So, what is an op amp now? What is it that we want from an op amp? We have used the op amp so far to do many miraculous things. What is it that we want from an op amp? What kind of characteristics do we want? Very high gain, that is the key, right? So, it is very high gain that gives you very high loop gain in negative feedback, that gives you virtual short between the input terminals of the op amp. Okay? So, that is the essential characteristic of the op amp. If the op amp does not have a high gain, it is not an op amp. Okay? Now, what is high is context dependent. In some cases like 50 may be high, in some cases 1 million may be high. Okay? So, but it has to be high. Now, again we are a little handicapped because we have not discussed transistors, but I mean the constituents of the op amp, the components with which we build the op amp. But still we can discuss some things in the abstract. So, the op amp is made using transistors, and most of the transistors that we know can be modeled as voltage controlled current sources. Okay. Now, what is a voltage controlled current source? It has something, some characteristic like this. So, let me show the prototype voltage controlled current source. So, if you have in general, this is what a voltage controlled current source is. If you have Vx between the controlling terminals, it will force a current Gm times Vx. Okay? So, that is what a voltage controlled current source is. Now, the transistor in particular, it turns out it has 3 terminals, not 4. So, here you have 4 terminals, right? 1, 2, 3 and 4, 2 controlling and 2 control terminals. Now, it turns out that the transistors have 3 terminals, that is one of the controlling terminals and one of the control terminals are tied together internally. Okay? So, inherently you have only 3 terminals and the current source direction is downwards. This is not very important whether it is downwards or upwards, you will have similar phenomenon, but this is how it is. So, you have Vx and Gm times Vx, and I will just call these 1, 2 and 3. Okay. So, the point of mentioning all this is that this is the basic control source we have. So, again we are trying to make amplifiers which are control sources, but the difference between an amplifier that we are trying to make and this one, what is it? Why are we making control sources with other control sources? Yeah. So, to have accurately defined gain values. So, in this case the Gm can vary substantially based on, I mean depending on temperature, it will also be different from transistor to transistor, but we want an accurate gain. Okay? So, now we want to build an op amp using this, right? How can we do that? So, let us say I want an op amp with a gain of a million and I have this transistor. So, give me a suggestion, how could I do that? What? What should I do? A naught is 10 to the 6 meaning I have Ve. By the way, for now we do not have to worry about this 3 terminal stuff, it may impose some restrictions. You can imagine control sources like this which have all 4 terminals free, that is okay, right? But tell me, give me an idea, how do I make basically a control source with V naught by Ve equals 10 to the 6, what should I do? What is that? Add a resistor to the load, because with this is a current source, we have to have. So, let us say I have this, I imagine something like this, and this is connected to ground, and I have some resistor, and this is V naught. So, what should the value of RL be? What should be the value of RL? I mean, can I put any resistance there? What is it that I should put? Yeah. So, this is if this looks so simple, right? If it is 10 to the 6 divided by GM, I have V naught by VE to be 10 to the 6. Okay. Only, I mean, it does not work like this because the transistor, it turns out, is not just a voltage control current source. It inherently has some parasitic conductance built into it, parasitic resistance. By the way, I think you should get comfortable with this. These resistors, like sometimes I show the conductance value, sometimes I show the resistance, okay, depending on which is convenient for analysis, right. I mean, if I use the letter G, it is a conductance, if I use the letter R, it is a resistance value. So, we will use that interchangeably because many times circuit analysis is very easy when you show conductances. When is this? Have you done any circuit analysis where you use conductance values instead of resistances, or at least the notation and all these things are easier? Where is that? What's that? Transmission line. No. Nodal analysis, that's all, right? So in nodal analysis, you have the conductance matrix times the voltage vector to be equal to the source current, current source vector. Okay. So of course you can keep on writing 1 by R1, 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2 plus 1 by R3. It is just more painful than writing G1 plus G2 plus G3. That's all. So that's something you have to get used to. Now the transistor inherently has this built-in G naught, and it turns out that. So, what is the, if I just measure V naught by Vx, what will that be? What is the value? What is that going to be just for the transistor by itself? G naught? GM G naught. GM divided by G naught. G naught is the output conductance value. So, GM divided by G naught. Okay. So, now if I have this G naught here, what happens? What will be the gain? What will be the gain if I have GM, G naught also here? GM divided by G naught plus GL. GL is the reciprocal of RL. Okay. So, this notation is very convenient. I am not going to write 1 by RL every time. You should get used to this one. Okay. Now, the point is, this GM by G naught, right, for a transistor, it is of the order of 10 to 100. Okay. Typically, it is hard to get more than this. You understand? So, the inherent G naught inside the transistor already limits the DC gain of the voltage controlled current source. If we had an ideal voltage controlled current source, we can load it with whatever resistance we want, okay, and then get a very large gain. Now, it turns out that inherently there is some G naught, and the value of G naught is in practice such that GM by G naught is of the order of 10 to 100. Okay. So, let us say GM by G naught is 100. You understand? GM by G naught is 100, and you make this circuit with RL being 10 to the 6 divided by GM. Okay. So, what will be V naught by V E in this circuit? What will it be? V naught by V E less than 100. Why? Obviously, G naught itself, GM by G naught gives you a gain of 100. Now, you have GM by G naught plus something. That something is very small. So, actually, this is not 10 to the 6, but very close to 100, simply the inherent gain of the transistor. Okay. So, you understand, we have this active device called the transistor, and the transistor can be very well modeled using a voltage controlled current source in some operating region. But the voltage controlled current source is not an ideal voltage controlled current source. Like any other current source, it has an internal output resistance. Okay. And also it turns out that with most transistors, the internal resistance value is such that the GM by G naught the transconductance divided by the output resistance is typically not more than 100, okay. There may be some special cases where you can get more than that, but they have some other undesirable characteristics, but it is about 100. So, let us say for now we will take that to be value of 100. So, clearly this means that if you try to make a voltage controlled voltage source using this, whatever you do, the gain will be less than 100, right, because the inherent voltage gain of the transistor itself is 100, and if you connect some other load to it, it will become less than 100, okay. So, this is just the device limitation. Tomorrow if somebody invents a new device which has a gain of 1,000,000, okay, go for it. You do not have to do all the things I tell you in the next few lectures, but today this is reality, you have to do this, okay. And in fact, in some of the most modern processes, which means very small transistors, you may have heard of terms like 14 nanometer and 22 nanometers and so on. So, that refers to the length of the transistor. Now, that is very good, because when you have small transistor, you can pack more of them, you can have a billion transistors on a single chip and all that stuff. And also when you have very small transistor, the charge carriers take very short time to go from here to there. So, that means that they will also be very fast, you can switch them very fast, but the smaller they are, the smaller this value is also. So, the number will be closer to 10 than 100, okay. Now, whatever this is, you still have to make an op amp, and let us say I still want an op amp with a gain of 1000, okay. At least let us first get to 1000 or 10,000 instead of a million. How would I do this? Or if I wanted a gain of 1,000,000, what should I do? What is that? 3 transistors? Okay. So, clearly you figure that, I mean, in general, if you have something, this is the typical symbol for an amplifier. So, this means that if the input voltage is something, the output voltage is A times V I. If you want a higher gain, you could put one more of that. So, you get A square times V I and so on. So, that is the idea. And this business of putting one amplifier after another is known as a cascade connection or cascading of amplifiers, okay. And clearly that is what you do. You use one transistor to go from V E to 100 times V E, and you use another transistor after that to go to 10 to the 4 times V E, and maybe one more after that to go to 10 to the 6, a million times V E. This is not sufficient, I will use one more. What is the voltage here? What is the voltage there? Gm by G naught squared times V E, and if I use one more, obviously, I will get the Q. Okay. So, it looks, I mean, not such a big problem after all. Even if I have transistor of gain 10, you put 6 of them one after another, and then you will get 10 to the 6. Okay. And why we stop at 1 million? If you want 100 million, it also looks like you can also get that, right? We put 2 more stages. Do you foresee any problems with this? The answer must be obvious, otherwise I won't even start on this direction. Many transistors. I just said you can put a million transistors on a chip. What is 6, right? That's not a big deal. Yeah, that's okay. I mean, if you want something, you have to dissipate energy. That's all. Right. We don't know the details of the transistor, but no, that's not a problem. We can set the operating region of any transistor any which way we want. Okay. That's okay. We will use the highest one. Why? No, we can have DC supply voltages, right? We do. I mean, even for an op amp, we need that. That we will for sure have it. Yeah, it should be higher than the output voltage, that is for sure, right? Because in the op amp also, the output voltage is limited to the supplies. So we have to have supply voltage that is greater than the voltages that you want. Okay. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Anyway, that's there is something missing from the circuit, something very important. When you build some circuits, there will be some elements that will be inevitably present that is not shown here. What might that be? Think of like making any connections between, we are talking about physical wires, not circuit diagrams, right? So, there will be some things that are always present. What is that? Inductances and capacitances. Okay. So, the moment you have any conductors of any finite extent, you will have inductances and capacitances. Anytime you have two conductors, you will have capacitance between them, and anytime you have some length of wire, you will have inductance. Now, it so happens that for the kind of dimensions that we are talking about and the typical relatively lower frequencies, again, what is low frequency? That keeps on changing. If the dimensions are very small, a gigahertz is also a low frequency. Inductances are not very important. The capacitances are more important. Okay, this just happens to be the case for the kind of circuits that we have. So, that means that if you try to build this, this is not the only thing that we will get, but we will also get capacitance. Actually, there will be a capacitance between every node and every other node, okay? Because, we normally say capacitance is a parallel plate, but who says they have to be like flat plates which have to be parallel, right? If you have two conducting things like at some distance, there will be some capacitance. Exactly how much the capacitance is depends on the shape of the conductors and also the separation between them and so on, but you will have capacitance. Of course, now if we go and connect like capacitances between every node and every other node, it will become very messy. So, we will take the dominant one. Typically, the dominant ones, not always, are between every node and there is a common ground in the circuit, right. So, because that ground is running everywhere and you have components connected to it, it turns out that this is the most dominant, and for now we will consider this one, okay. Now, this capacitance comes from everything. I said, okay, I made it appear as though when you put two transistors together, it will be in the wire that is between the two transistors. But that is not just it. The transistor itself has a non-zero size. So, if you take a transistor, there will be some capacitance between its different terminals. Okay. So, anything that whose size is more than 0, which is basically everything, will have some capacitances between its terminals. Okay. So, this will always be there. And for me now, completely arbitrarily, let me assume that all these are equal to each other. Absolutely no reason to assume that, but let's do that. So, what's the result of this? So, let's say this is V naught, this is V e. Whenever you have capacitors, you have to resort to differential equations to solve it, and of course, the easier way of doing that is through Laplace transforms, where instead of differential equations, you get algebraic equations, right. And how do you characterize a circuit block? Through its transfer function, which is the ratio of the output voltage to the input voltage. So, what is that going to be in this case? Please calculate it quickly. And in fact, what I want is not just V naught by V e, but let me call this V o 1 and V o 2. So, please calculate V o by V e, V o 1 by V e, and VO2 by VE. So, what do you get? VO1 by VE. It's basically instead of GM by G naught, you have the total admittance, which is G naught plus S times CP. Okay. And most of the times, it is useful when you have voltage gains to have the numerator and denominator to be dimensionless. Okay. So, what kind of a transfer function is that? It's a low pass filter. What is the DC gain? GM by G naught. It had to be, right? Because the gain of this stage when the capacitor was not there was GM by G naught, and that is nothing but the DC gain. So, that is again This is a very simple circuit, but that is the kind of sanity check you should use. And it has one pole. What is the value of the pole? G naught by Cp. Okay. So, it is a low pass transfer function, and obviously, if you calculate V naught, in this case the three stages are identical. This does not necessarily have to be the case. Okay. The Gm values, G naught values and the capacitor values can be different for each stage, but I am just trying to illustrate the point qualitatively. So, in this case we have Gm by G naught 1 plus S Cp by G naught square, and V naught by Ve will be okay. So, all of them are of course low pass filters. If you look at V naught by Ve, what is the DC gain? G naught by G naught cube, obviously. Again, we had already analyzed the circuit assuming no capacitors, and that is what we had, and it has three poles all identical at G naught divided by Cp. Okay. So, what? Why did we do all this? So, clearly if you want to have high gain, you will put multiple stages together, which necessarily means that you will have multiple poles like 3 for instance. And from your tutorial analysis, you know that if you do put this in negative feedback loop, there is a very good chance that it will become unstable. Okay. Did you calculate the value of A naught by K? So, I think if I remember right, the problem given was first of all, let us forget the poles and so on. Let us recall something. What was V naught by Vi in this case? K. No, no, that is if the gain is infinity. When the gain was not infinity, we calculated that. What was that? It was K divided by some number more than 1. What was that? 1 plus K by A naught, obviously. This had better be close to K, right? And the larger the value of A naught by K, the closer this is to being ideal. And what is this A naught by K? We also gave some name for it. What was that? It is the loop gain. So, if you break the loop, apply some stimulus and see what returns around the loop, that is A naught by K times the stimulus. And this has to be very large. Okay. That is the whole point of making negative feedback circuits. Now, instead of this being A naught, this is A naught by S plus P 1 cube. As you said, this will become unstable. And do you remember the value of A naught by K for which it becomes unstable? What do you care? Do you ask to calculate that or no? No. How did you find that it is unstable? Greater than 1. No, that is not correct. We will do it again. Anyway, I will show it in detail. But so, it turns out that it is actually 8. Right? If A naught by K is more than 8, it will become unstable. But the point is, now you can say I will keep A naught by K to be small enough so that I do not become unstable, but A naught by K of 8 is such a measly small value that you won't never want to use that, right? You want A naught by K of large value, of which are very large. So, that does not work at all. Now, from this you can see each transistor gives you a limited gain. If you have a single transistor in feedback, you are likely to have only one pole, but actually we will find that even that is not necessarily true. So, if you have a single transistor in feedback, you will get a nice and stable circuit, but the loop gain is very small. Okay, so, it is not useful. You have to put multiple transistors in feedback, typically more than 2, and when you do that, there is a risk of instability. Instability meaning, I mean, an amplifier, instead of amplifying what is given, it will start singing by itself, right? So, it will start oscillating and then you will have an output without any input. Okay. So, that is unstable and that is useless. So, we have to, and this is a big part of the course and a very important thing also, we have to see how to make these things stable even when you have multiple poles. Okay. So, that will occupy us for the next several classes. Now, why do you think it becomes unstable? The negative feedback becomes unstable. What is it about the poles that makes it unstable actually? So, let us say let's just take one stage. Again, we'll formalize all these things. I don't want to start on something new now. Okay. So let's say the input is a step. Okay. What will the output be? First of all, first assume that there is no capacitor with Cp equal to 0, what will be the output? The input Va is a step, this is the circuit, what is the output? Huh? Without the capacitor, what is the output? Yeah, it will also be a step whose value is Gm by G naught times Ve, if this is Ve. Okay? Of course, this is highly unrealistic, you will never have 0 capacitor, and this Gm by G naught could be large, let us say 100 or something. Now, with the capacitor Cp, what will be the output? What is it? You know the transfer function, right? V naught by V is Gm by G naught divided by 1 plus S Cp by G naught. So, what is the step response? It will decay. Why? It will exponentially, I mean it is a first order low pass filter, right? It is no different from this RC qualitatively. What is the difference between this and that? Huh? What is the DC gain of this? 1. So, V naught will rise exponentially until it reaches V I. In the other case, it will rise exponentially until it reaches G m by G naught times V I. So, it will actually do something like this and eventually reach that. Okay? So, it takes some time. Now, let us consider two stages. Cp. Then without capacitor, what should be the output? What is for a step response? What should be the step response? Gm by G naught square. I will show it on the same graph. I will pretend now that this is Gm by G naught square. Now, with the two capacitors, what will the output be? What do you think? Huh? It will be even slower. But importantly, what will be the, yeah, it is true, it will eventually reach Gm by G naught square. Okay. But how does it start off? When it starts off, how does it start? What will be the starting slope? Again, you can think back to the first order and second order responses. Huh? What will be the starting slope? Anyway, you can think about it, we will continue from there. So, the summary is that you need multiple native amplifier stages, multiple transistors to realize an op amp which is of any use because you want a high gain. But the moment you do that, you will automatically have multiple poles in the feedback system. And that is not the only thing, I mean those are not the poles in the op amp are not the only ones. Like for instance, here you have another pole, right, because there will always be a parasitic capacitor between that point and ground. So, in a feedback loop, you will have many poles. So, once you have, it turns out more than 2 poles, it is not necessarily stable, and even with 2 poles, things can be quite bad even if stable. So, we have to see how to make the response of the amplifier be well behaved, whatever that well behaved means, we will discuss that. Okay.